On the debate tonight, the decision of an NGO to provide pure veg, non-garlic and non-onion meals has triggered a big controversy. RTI reply reveals that despite government recommendation, Akshay Patra Foundation has refused to include onion and garlic in the midday meals they serve to over 15,000 schools across 12 states.
Back in 2013, when a committee was set up here to review especially the standards of the food which is provided as a part of midday meal scheme, they found out that the food which is provided especially in Bangalore urban and as well as a Dharwad district was at poor. It was mediocre.
Many children and parents claim the midday meal without onions and garlic is too bland for consumption.
Jack Medala.
Activists, on the other hand, claim the food provided by Akshay Patra doesn't meet the nutritional requirements of growing children.
It has been known for a very long time that the food is not tasty, people are not liking it. Since 2013, the coverage of the midday meal schemes in the schools where Akshay Patra has been supplying has been extremely low. Children have been opting out. Consumption has been very low. People are consuming less than what they are required to consume as per MHRD norms.
A claim completely refuted by the foundation.
We have data to prove that our food is safe, nutritious, and tasty. Mm-hmm. And if there is any contrary point, we welcome any organization to, which is appointed by the government, of course, mm-hmm. to come and evaluate what we are doing and give a feedback to us.
As the controversy over vegetarian midday meals snowballs, Mira now asks, should midday meals have a non-veg option? Let's debate.
Well, good evening. So it's a simple question. It's obviously non-debatable whether or not eggs are good for children when they're growing up. The question is, can you substitute eggs with vegetables and not harm in any way the calorific content or the nutrition content of the meal? And if you knock out onions and garlic, will that make the meal unappetizing for children, which is what is being reported out of Karnataka at this point? So should the midday meal, whose main purpose is to feed children who would otherwise be malnourished, should it have a non-vegetarian option as well? And by non-vegetarian, we simply mean eggs, because that's what's prescribed by most state governments. On the show with me this evening, Siddharth Joshi, an independent researcher, Dr. Manjari Chandra is a dietitian, Rahul Ishwar is a social activist, Dr. M.D. Ramamurthy, Professor of Community Medicine, Anjali Bhardwaj is a member of Right to Food campaign, and we have Anurag Naidu of Think Right. Welcome all of you to this conversation, and thank you for joining us. Siddharth Joshi, you're among those people who objected to the meal in question. Could you tell us what your arguments are to begin with, that the meals should include onions and garlic and eggs perhaps also?
Yes, so basically where the issue began was...
Yes, go on.
In 2013, when in certain districts where Akshay Patra is one of the biggest suppliers, the consumption by the children was found to be extremely low. And it continues to till date. In Bangalore urban, for example, in the primary schools, 20% of the children have actually opted out of midday meal schemes. And 80% of the children who are within the scheme are not consuming the prescribed amount of food that they are supposed to consume as per the MHRD norms. So that's where the issue began. The Food Commission, which is an independent body set up under the National Food Security Act, had gone to several of these schools, have inquired into it, and have then asked the government to ask Akshay Patra to follow suit, because there was a prescribed menu and Akshay Patra was not following it, even though they had signed an MOU with the government that they will follow the menu. In November last year, Akshay Patra was ordered to follow the menu. But between November and April of this year, the government did a U-turn and completely went back on their earlier position and allowed a completely ad hoc waiver to Akshay Patra, while everybody else, while every say other organization is being asked to follow that prescribed menu, Akshay Patra is being given a very ad hoc and biased waiver by the government.
Well, let me bring in the rest of the panel as well. Dr. Manjari Chandra is a dietitian. Dr. Chandra, do you believe that there should be a non-vegetarian option or eggs should be included?
Yeah, you know, as you had initially started the debate with saying that these midday meals are intended to nourish children who otherwise would go malnourished and without food, we know that they're coming from the marginalized section of the society. We know that they're coming from low socioeconomic groups. I mean, the most important thing is to make the food tasty and nutritious. And especially in a place like Karnataka, which is predominantly a non-vegetarian state, unlike Gujarat or North India, where people are mostly vegetarians, it definitely is a very good idea. In fact, it should be promptly a decision of whoever is running the organization to add eggs, dairy, vegetables, things like ginger and garlic, which are so protective, onions, which add taste and nutrition to the food, to go ahead and do that. Also, these things are quite cheap in terms of, you know, attaining them in bulk, unlike meat or unlike nuts. They're not very costly. Eggs and vegetables are comparatively cheaper commodities. So I fail to understand why an organization which is feeding children midday meals, and especially marginalized children, should even think of not having them in their menu.
Well, Rahul Ishwar, social activist, disagrees. Rahul Ishwar, go ahead.
There are two reasons. See, the entire debate started in this dimension by an article in The Hindu. First of all, it was very partial. It was very unbalanced and a partial approach by Hindu. They have not even given a good word for Akshay Patra, who did such commendable work.
Yes.
Akshay Patra is almost serving 1.6 million children every day, and they have kitchens across 12 different states and 33 different locations. They are doing a great job. They are a spiritual organization. They too have their own rules and regulations. And according to our belief, even in our houses, we have some reservations with onion and garlic because there is a belief that it is a tamasic food. It is, you know, the sattvic, rajasic, tamasic food, and it is a tamasic food. So there are some spiritual reservations regarding this topic. The most important aspect of this is nutrition, not taste. Is the Akshay Patra organization following the nutritional standard? That is the core question, not what the taste is. Please remember, it is a great effort. They are reaching to millions of people. Rather than appreciating or rather than giving a constructive criticism, it seems like, at least for some people, an unfair hit job on Akshay Patra on a very unbalanced and a one-sided one.
Well, I just want to point out, Rahul Ishwar, you said that this started with an article in The Hindu.
No.
It didn't really. It started in 2013 when the question arose. So it's far beyond the one newspaper article. This has been going on for a very long time. In fact, there are 990 activists who have written to the government repeatedly asking them to relook at it. Secondly, I want to point out that our reporter has discovered that the individual who gave the nutritional certificate to the Akshay Patra meal is in fact on one of the committees of the Akshay Patra. There is a conflict of interest there. But the question that we're simply asking is this: should there be an influence of religious philosophy on government programs? And I did see Siddharth Joshi put his hand up. Siddharth Joshi, you want to give Rahul Ishwar a rebuttal?
Yeah, I mean, as you said, this issue started much earlier. It didn't start with the Hindu report. It actually started with an independent body constituted under the National Food Security Act, the Karnataka State Food Commission, which had gone and observed these things in the schools. Second of all, the MHRD guidelines expressly prohibit propagation of religious practices through MDM. Clause 2.11 of midday meal schemes expressly prohibit any kind of religious practices being propagated to MDM. This is not allowed. People can have private beliefs, but they can't propagate them through the midday meal schemes.
Okay, we also
Nobody
have... Okay, go ahead, Rahul.
Just one
yes,
line.
Fine.
One
Can
thing.
I add a word?
One, nobody is propagating it. Second, everybody knows that it didn't start by Hindu. I said the recent controversy and it became such a national news and debate because there is a there was an article in Hindu which caught the social media attention for and against. Yes, there was some kind of news and controversy earlier too. Please remember, every organization too have their own norms. So you need to find a comfortable middle ground between these two. There are other organizations who also does this, but not on this scale. Please remember, providing 1.6 million students meal every day is not a simple task. You know, you simply, when you blame some organization or when you blanketly blame some organization, please at least have the courtesy to point out the great work they are doing. It seems one-sided, at least for a huge number of people in social media, because many people feel the criticisms are too one-sided and not constructive in nature.
All right. Let me also bring in Dr. Anjali Bharadwaj. She's a member of the Right Hi. To Food campaign. Anjali ji, Dr. Chandra, I'll come back to you immediately after this. Anjali, go ahead.
Yes.
Let me just start by saying, Faye, that the malnutrition of children in India is a matter of huge concern. There are figures to suggest that it's worse than sub-Saharan Africa. We are dealing with a problem of this nature. When the National Food Security Act talked about the midday meals, the MDMs, the whole idea was that there must be a system, a food security mechanism, which covers children, which ensures that they get food that they would like to consume, and which makes sure that they get the nutrition that they require to lead a healthy life of dignity. Now, with that context, I want to approach this whole debate. Look, the issue here is that for anyone who has children, they should not find it difficult to understand that children have certain preferences. I have two daughters. I know how difficult it is to make sure that they eat their meal and they get all the nutrition. Now, what was expected through the MDM was that locally procured, locally produced food would be made available to children, which would suit their palate, their taste, so that the children in our country would actually get some food to eat, which would sustain them, which would give them the nutrition that is required. That is the bottom line. I don't want to go into who's doing a good job or who's not. I'm sure if there are many children which Akshay Patra is catering to and where they're liking that food and consuming it, we are not arguing about that. The issue yes. here is that if children in Karnataka, in different places, are used to eating food, cultural preferences are there, they're used to eating food with garlic, with ginger, with onion in it, there should be no reason why they should be denied that. And what we are looking at is a mammoth problem in the delivery system if we make an organization the centerpiece of all of this.
Yes.
What needs to be understood is that what is the food specification that's required, what are the tastes of the children, and the menu should be prepared accordingly. After that, anyone who can actually deliver that should be gotten in to do that. If there is no Akshay Patra, there will be a self-help group certainly that can be set up. More locally procured, produced food can be given to the children. There is absolutely no rationale for saying that children should not eat the food that is meant for them because certain ingredients, because an organization believes in a certain spiritual philosophy or religious philosophy, should not be given to children.
Right.
And look at the science. I mean, there are any number of studies to show, and you have a nutritionist on the show as well,
yes.
of so, the kind of value, nutritional value, protein value that eggs bring to children. So why should they be denied? Children who do eat eggs. We are not saying force children who don't eat eggs, who are vegetarian, to eat eggs, but children who do eat eggs, why should they be denied this particular food?
Well, I want to take the question back to Dr. Chandra. Dr. Chandra, you know, and from the point of view of news, I must bring this to your attention. under normal circumstances, whenever we've covered the midday meal or a story about the midday meal, it's because, you know, the food was bad or it caused children to fall sick or they found lizards in it or they found cockroaches in it or there was something or the other wrong. The Akshay Patra is, from what we understand, ISO certified in all of its kitchens and provides food that doesn't have any of the problems that I just listed out. Now, if we put that on the table as well and consider the fact that this is clean food that's being prepared fresh, that's, you know, ISO certified, arriving for children, if you weigh the two options together, should we let go of the garlic and the onion in the balance?
You know, Faye, definitely what you're saying is correct. And also what the gentleman said in terms of the numbers that they are reaching, in terms of the number of children that they are addressing, I believe he quoted a figure of 1.6 million. Of course, that's a huge number. And that's a great service to the nation. But the whole conflict or the whole conversation here is not about the fact that they are doing it. We obviously acknowledge that. And as somebody said, there is a scientific principle or a guideline to be followed. You cannot, because one of your principal beliefs or your religious or your spiritual beliefs, do something that's detrimental to the health of a growing population. You know, when we speak of malnutrition in India, it's so widespread. And we're talking about a sector that has already not been exposed to good food. Why do we want to compromise there? Why do we want to get into a space where children will not end up eating the allocated food if they do not like the taste? If it does not have the required nutrition, then there is half the purpose of doing it is beaten. Yes, I completely buy the fact that hygiene has been looked into. You haven't come up with incidences like rodents being reported or lizards or cockroaches being found. The kitchens are clean. All those certifications, the ISO that you talked about, has been done. But, you know, even then, also the FSSAI has come up with the SNF guidelines, Safe and Nutritious Food Guidelines. And these guidelines also talk about the nutrition content of the food.
Okay,
only
safety of the food cannot be a parameter.
And it does not become...
Yes. Dr. Chandra, will garlic and onion, with the removal or the omission of garlic and onion, and I want to also say that the Akshay Patra has said that it's replaced it with green leafy vegetables and fresh vegetables. Will that make a difference to the nutritional content? Will it bring it down in any way?
I think two things here, Faye. One is the taste and the acceptability. Second is, I lived in Bangalore for a very long time, predominantly a place where people use garlic and onion in their everyday cooking. That's a taste that they're used to. Also, you know, garlic and onion do add some nutrition. I completely understand that unlike egg, they are not major sources of nutrition. But I think here the taste is more a defining factor, especially when you're making lunch for children on a daily basis. It gives you the opportunity to add some sort of taste and flavor to the food. But yes, these are not nutritional products in the first space. They may have some amount of protective nutrition, but they're not really contributors to micronutrient load.
Okay.
But I think it's more about the concept of sort of force feeding something which aligns with a certain sect or a certain belief system or a certain spiritual system. And that, I think, when you're doing something at such a large scale, it should be more, you know, something which is more inclusive, something which is also more,
Let me just bring in a couple of other voices. All right, I understand what you're saying. I understand what you're saying. We also have Anurag Naidu who joins us right now. Anurag, Mithilesh Kumar has asked us a question. He said, what is the logic behind an onion-free midday meal? The truth is, for those of us in the South, we know that sambar without onions is actually... It's barely sambar, honestly. So tell me this. What is the logic for the children? And everybody knows it's difficult to get children to eat food that's not exciting. What is the logic behind removing onions and garlic for food for children?
Hey, first of all, Akshay Patra has not been serving food only in Karnataka. They've been serving food, very healthy midday meal, across 12 states of India, which is significant to understand. Now, since this question has come up only in Karnataka, it's okay that we're taking a debate, but then, as Rahul Ishwar rightly mentioned, Hindu is making it a biased debate on one side. let us, you know, this kind of arguments come when we forget our roots. I recall my school days when I used to go to one of the government schools and the food was absolutely not hygienic. And then comes Akshay Patra, makes everything so hygienic. People have been praising about Akshay Patra's hygiene. When it is about nutrition versus hygiene, even if it may be my own children for that matter, I would definitely prefer hygiene over taste. Now, what we are asking is a very valid question, Faye, that in sambar and other things. But what for me the most important thing is, we know the fact that egg yolks are very nutritious, but then for some of them it might not taste good. We are so addicted to some things like oats, but they don't taste good either. But what is more disheartening is some of the activists who are turning out to be nutritionists overnight and blaming and telling Akshay Patra is forcefully trying to impose religious beliefs, which is absolutely unfair that we are doing to Akshay Patra. They're open for suggestions. We can go and suggest that, boss, you don't have this. Kindly make sure that you do this for this state. And they're ready to listen to your suggestions. But then you don't go to them with suggestions. You take them into some media trial, which is very unfortunate for us to be doing, because Akshay Patra is not imposing their food onto the students, but rather they are trying to serve the students. And we must...
Siddharth Joshi, would you want to respond to that? Hasn't the government already asked that this be corrected, or have the activists asked that this be corrected in the past?
Yeah. The government has on multiple occasions reiterated that Akshay Patra has to follow the prescribed menu. The argument made is here is like you can choose whatever you want as long as it's vanilla. why not onion and garlic, right? If children want it, why can't that be supplied? That's a simple question. Nobody is answering the question as to why. What is the problem with onion and garlic? If the students want it, if the student like it, it has to be supplied. A contractor has to supply it. The interest of the contractor cannot be put beyond above the interest of the children's here.
Can I point out one thing?
Yes, Rahul.
And the second point I would like to make is
it is extremely unfortunate to to brand them as contractors who get some kind of a benefit out of doing this. They are doing it out of social service. They are doing it out of genuine reaching out and a philanthropic aspect. And we are demeaning them by calling them contractors. That's the reason why many of us suspect that, is there something more than it meets the eye? Because is it more of an ideological aversion? Is it more like a political or a spiritual aversion to Akshay Patra? See, they have their own systems. We have to respect that too. We cannot totally ignore their own systems, and we cannot tell them to compromise. Suppose if tomorrow somebody asks beef in the school, do you expect Akshay Patra to provide beef in the school, saying that we really choose beef over any other food? So you have to be realistic and you have to be very sensitive to such great people. And please remember, they backed the Gandhi fight.
Hang on, one second. Rahul Ishwar, nobody is doubting the greatness of the people that we're referring to, but nobody is doing this job for free either. Akshay Patra gets paid 4.13 rupees per child per meal in the primary school and 6.18 rupees per child per meal in the secondary school. And this is the standard government of India, state government norms of payment per plate of food. So this isn't charity. Let's be very clear. Effectively, these are vendors or contractors to the government, because what I'm holding in my hand is a contract with the government of Karnataka. When you sign a contract, that makes you a contractor, Rahul Ishwar.
But please remember, do you seriously believe that the food they are providing is only worth 4 rupees? Do you seriously believe the food they are providing is only worth 6 or 8 rupees? See the hygiene.
Well, if you drop some of the ingredients that you are supposed to put on the list.
Anurag Naidu rightly pointed out.
Yes.
Please remember, nutritional value is the core issue.
Okay.
If they are faulting on nutritional value, yes, you have
okay.
a point.
All right,
you
so nutritional value. All right,
all
good
the
point.
All children demanding onion and garlic.
All right, nutritional value, we have three people who want to answer that question, but I'll go to Dr. Chandra first. Dr. Chandra is a dietitian. Same question, nutritional value. Does this alter the nutritional value? Because what Siddharth Joshi will argue is that the government of Karnataka has a list of ingredients that must be on the plate. The list that is going to the plate is minus onion and garlic. Dr. Chandra.
Yes. You know, all these arguments, the voices that I hear, I think are not really trying to figure out what we're trying to say. It's not a question of how much money Akshay Patra or anybody is getting out of that food. It's obviously not philanthropy. As you correctly said, it's somebody who's supplying food. Yes, it's done in good interest of the children. It's a government-run scheme, but it's not philanthropy. So let's not, you know, put it on a pedestal and say that, listen, this is some great work. They're good work for sure, and there's good hygiene they maintain. Listen, this is not a good argument. There is no reason why, when you have a list of ready ingredients and a set of guidelines to adhere to, that you should not be following them. I see no validation of why the onion and garlic is missing, why eggs are not being given to children, or why taste or nutrition should be compromised at any cost. I understand there is absolutely no validity to what they're trying to say, neither a spiritual aspect to it, nor the money aspect, nor the religious aspect, nor the philanthropic aspect. I think all of it is just to create noise. The fact is there is a set of instructions, there is a list of food items, there are stuff that is to be followed. And it's a good idea when you're doing it at such a large scale for such a large number of children, try to stick to guidelines, because then it makes it purposeful, okay. It makes it complete instead of leaving a void in the system.
All right, a couple of people on the phone line. Narayan on the phone line from Bangalore. Narayan, good evening, go ahead.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, go ahead.
What I want to say is, fundamentally, we must start testing the water that these children are drinking on a 6-monthly basis, send it to some lab. Fundamentally, the schools don't have teachers, they don't have toilets, and now we are looking at whether to add one piece of onion or not. Now, set apart, let me tell you, when my children were going to school, I think both my children studied in Christian schools, but in the schools, non-veg lunch box is banned. This is where some of the children are taking veg, some of the children are taking non-veg, some of these take egg. Okay, I am not a nutrition specialist, but what I want to suggest is, if any of your panelists, let them take 10 schools on a voluntary basis, run it, prove it that our marks have improved, nobody gets punished when things go wrong in the midday meal schemes. A rat is fallen, that is 2 days newspaper. And nobody gets punished in this country. And yes. So many children are taken to hospital for food poisoning. Any of these people, are they from any voluntary organizations? Can any of them stand up and say, I have run 20 schools, improved the nutrition of children? They get some college degree, they are consultants. Let them work, give the papers.
Okay,
Repeatability is more important.
Okay, all right. B.S. Ved Prakash on the phone line from Bangalore. Mr. Ved Prakash, go ahead.
I'm Ved Prakash. I worked in the DRDO for a long time. I just wanted to say that eating without garlic and egg, particularly egg, and then onions, this could lead to what is known as vitamin B12 and D deficiency, because I myself was born as a vegetarian. Later on, switched over to eggs when I felt it was necessary after being advised by the doctors. So, we get into the problem of malnutrition. 1-odd percent may not get in, but most of the religious institutions, what they provide food is not a complete food, because the reason being, it does not contain the necessary ingredients for the children to develop. And I myself, being a victim of that, I definitely would like to say that at least eggs, 3 days in 3 days in a week must be provided. But non-vegetarian, I'm not proposing, because it's difficult to maintain cleanliness.
Yes,
but I would definitely agree to provide the ingredients.
Yes, Mr. Ved Prakash, very valid points. Let's answer the questions that our viewers have asked us. But we also have Dr. Ramamurthy, who joins us right now, Professor of Community Medicine, joining us from Bangalore. Dr. Ramamurthy, good evening, and thank you for giving us your time. Here's the question that we're asking. The entire controversy of whether or not the religious philosophy of not including onions and garlic and eggs in the midday meal, in a country where, from latest research has told us, we have the most number of malnourished children in the world. Do you believe that the omission of certain ingredients is valid? Will it cost us? Which side of this argument are you on, Dr. Ramamurthy?
Omission of these ingredients Wonderful question. Thank you. Omission of these essential ingredients like garlic, onion, and eggs as first-class protein is a crime against children. That is my very strong view, because we must understand that eating habits evolve from one's kitchen, caste, class, religious, and geographic locations. Depriving government school children of tasty and nutritious food because of certain religious beliefs is not proper at all, and I feel it's antisocial. Government's memorandum of understanding with Akshay Patra should be cancelled, I feel. See, removing garlic and onion and eggs from midday meals in Karnataka has already led to more school dropouts, and we must understand that nearly half of the children, or the school-going children or under fives, suffer from malnutrition. So, government and Akshay Patra should stop playing with children's food. Children on egg-free diets suffer impaired growth. I mean, and you know, let me tell you, the statistics say it is nearly half of the children suffer from protein energy malnutrition. And egg is considered as a biologically complete protein because it has all the essential amino acids that are required for our growth, repair, and all that to protect our health. They act as protective foodstuffs. And it's also classified, labeled as first-class protein,
yes.
Egg. Here in Karnataka, school children are happy. They're not happy. They're unhappy with the midday meal. Hence, no institution should impose religion in the midday meal.
Okay. Dr. Ramamurthy, Rahul Ishwar has a rebuttal.
And I strongly vouch for the above views.
Yes, Rahul Ishwar has a rebuttal. Rahul Ishwar, go ahead.
Yeah?
With due respect to the doctor,
hello?
After hearing him, I think Akshay Patra should be maybe hanged or maybe punished for crimes against
you
humanity.
Might be overreacting, Rahul Ishwar, please.
See, who was overreacting, ma'am? Who was overreacting? Who was calling it a crime? See, please remember, those who can, they do. Those who can't, they criticize. There is a point of fair debate. There were many people who were raising a fair point. There is unfair criticism. That is extremely unfortunate. You are some people are demonizing an organization
say,
which is...
Let me have a say. Please. Hello.
Okay, all right. Dr. Ramamurthy, go ahead.
Hello. Hello.
Dr. Ramamurthy,
hello?
Go ahead.
Yeah, let me have a say. Yeah, this is government's memorandum of understanding with Akshay Patra. If they're not supplying this midday meal free of cost, they are being paid, and it is their bounden duty to respect the terms and conditions laid down by the government, and they cannot offer lame excuses that it, you know, it, that comes in the way of religious beliefs, that this and all that. They're all bullshit views. I say bullshit views.
All right. We want to keep the language here. Dr. Ramamurthy, we heard you out. I apologize to my viewers for the bad language. Let me just rephrase the question. The question is this. Let's keep in mind that the midday meal is different from the lunch that you and I carry in our dappas. It's different from the lunch that you and I have at home, because we're looking to manage our diets
shall I tell you?
Just 1 second, sir. The midday meal is perhaps the only full meal that child gets. Research has shown us that a lot of children go in that category of schooling, go to school on an empty stomach. They don't have breakfast. They perhaps don't have an adequate dinner either. This is their one square meal of the day. So it's supposed to be a booster of nutrition. It can't just be enough.
Yes. Nutrition.
It's not what's enough for
Correct.
You and me. Let me take this question back to Anjali.
Nutrition.
Yes. One second. Anjali Bharadwaj, I have a question for you, and we did. This has come up now thrice.
Yeah, one second.
Anjali Bharadwaj, the question of, and you are a member of the Right to Food campaign and the Rozi Roti Adhikar Abhiyan, the criticism that activists actually just sit around and criticize and they don't really do any work. If you want to do the work, why don't you do it yourself? Do you want to respond to that, Anjali Bharadwaj?
Look, there are two or three things, because I've been listening very patiently, Faye. Let me just bring those on. The first thing is that, look, we are talking about giving a square meal to a child who otherwise would probably not have the chance to get the kind of nutrition that they can be given under the midday meal. So we need to make sure that all the nutrition that can be provided, including through eggs, must be provided. It does not matter who the provider is. The provider can always be changed if it is required. We are not saying that somebody should be forced to provide something, but should someone not want to provide what is needed to be provided, please change them. The idea is to give children nutrition, and secondly, it has to be given in a form that the child will consume. They will not leave it. And we know that we all have a certain taste for things. It's cultural. It depends on where we are coming from, which is why it had to be. It's the state governments that are responsible for making sure that this happens. It has to be local. The second thing which I want to bring out is this binary which is constantly brought about, which is that, look, either you can have a clean meal, or which is hygienic, or you can have the nutrition that you want. I'm sorry, I do not buy this idea. It is perfectly possible, if there is attention paid to accountability, that whoever is providing food does it properly. Nobody wants children to get food which is not hygienically prepared. But there must be accountability that is properly fixed. There should be frameworks, and they are there in the National Food Security Act if anyone wants to ensure that it happens. So we don't have to be dependent on just Akshay Patra or any other organization to provide midday meals which are hygienic. If the government does its job properly, the framework performs properly of accountability, that should be done even by self-help groups. Now, the third thing that we are constantly hearing is, like I said, nobody is taking away anything from any organization. But to make it sound like anyone is doing, Akshay Patra is doing a favor to the millions of children in this country, I'm sorry, we need to see things for what they are. They are applying for a contract to provide food to these children. And it is for these children that they must cook if they bid for the contract and they get it. If they don't want to provide what the children need and what they want to eat, then they need to move out and some other contractor will come in who needs to be monitored properly to provide the right kind of food. Okay. And as far as who is doing what, why doesn't somebody do something, let me just say that this is not as new as any Hindu article or any other article. We have been for decades saying that provide good, nutritious, hot cooked meals to children. And I don't think that we should make a virtue of the fact that one centralized organization is providing food for so many children. It's much better if the food is locally procured and produced in any case. So governments need to get their acts in order. Mm. And we need to make sure that children get the food that they deserve in terms of nutrition and the taste.
All right. Opening up for rebuttals. Anurag Naidu, go ahead.
Hey, let us... I don't know whether we agree or not, but I believe Akshay Patra is the best available option that we had in India. Second, whether it is Akshay Patra or any organization in India is faulting any rule or disobeying any rule of government of India or any state government, they have no right to function. And the government should be the first one to reprimand them. Second, most important thing is, if Akshay Patra is not serving nutritious food, if there is a question on nutrition value, I would be the first person to say we don't want them. But then we have to prove that they are not nutritious enough. So, and if we are not supposed to do the media trial for such an organization that has been doing philanthropy, that has been doing an act of social service, we should be holding the government responsible, and we should question the government and the local authorities for granting them permission. Can we go back to the government and ask them whether you have a better option? most of the MPs will agree to the fact that we do not have a better option. We can make them serve better. We can make them cook better. They're open for... Akshay Patra has given an official statement that they're open. Position. Can we discuss?
Okay, all right. Siddharth Joshi, are they open to suggestions? And unfortunately, I have to tell our audience, given that the Congress party has decided not to participate in any conversation on television for the month after the election, they're not here to answer our questions about what the government of Karnataka stand is on the matter. So, Siddharth Joshi, has the organization been open to suggestions so far in your experience through this entire 3 or 4 year process?
No, Akshay Patra has completely refused to comply with the orders of the government. I also like to remind everyone that the number of schools in Karnataka that Akshay Patra is supplying is only 4% of all the schools in Karnataka.
Go ahead.
The number of children that Akshay Patra is supplying to constitutes only 7% of children in Karnataka. So it's not like they are irreplaceable. There are several other organizations which are doing good work. But I think what I'm hearing, the argument is because they are doing good work, they can be allowed to flout the norms. They can be allowed to violate MHRD guidelines. They can be allowed to violate the contract because they are doing good work. I think that is not acceptable. Any organizations, even if they are doing good work, they have to comply with the norms of the government. And the last point I would like to make is that everybody, Anurag, for example, spoke about nutritious food. The point is this, if the food is not palatable, if it's not tasty, if children are actually throwing it in the drain, then what is the point of that all that food if it's not going into the stomach of the children? The food has to be eaten for that nutrition to go to the bodies of children. That's what's not happening. So let's not reduce midday meals to just the nutrition aspect of it. The taste of it, the consumption of it by children is the primary thing.
That's actually a very good point, Rahul Ishwar. If the children are not eating the food, then what is the entire argument? The process is now defeated.
How much empirical evidence do we have that the students are not eating it?
There is, in fact, plenty of empirical evidence.
I have read those articles. How can we speak for all the taste of
you
all the children?
Please don't try to confuse the community.
At least on the
if
face
you,
of it,
I have the hands-on experience in the villages
it seems
where
like a hit
most
job.
Of the most of the food.
Okay, all right, you're speaking at the same time. One second. Rahul Ishwar wants empirical evidence. Dr. Ramamurthy, do you have empirical evidence that the children are not eating the food?
See, I'm a regular visitor to villages and the school children. I have a wonderful rapport, hands-on experience, and I have eaten at schools several times, and it is not tastier, and most of the food staff is going down the drain. It is wasted because children find it, they're not happy with the,
That is anecdote, sir, not empirical evidence.
Seeing is believing, madam. Where do I, gather all this?
Okay, one second. Siddharth Joshi had an answer to this. One second, gentlemen, one second. Siddharth Joshi, go ahead. Yes, one second. Evidence, Siddharth.
Since empirical evidence is being asked for, I will quote from the annual work plan and budget for 2018-19. This is data available at the MHRD website. For Bangalore Urban, where 50% of the schools are being supplied by Akshay Patra, the coverage of the scheme is 79.90%, which means 20.1% children have actually opted out of the scheme. I can again quote from the minutes of meeting of the review of midday meal schemes, which is available at the MHRD website, where they say the consumption of food grains by children who are actually opting in is as low as 90% of what they are required to eat. So children are not liking it. They are preferring food. They want to go to home if their homes are nearby and eat the food there, or they prefer to bring food from their homes. They're opting out of the scheme. This is empirical evidence available at the MHRD website. Anybody can go and see. This is empirical evidence which has been submitted to the government of Karnataka, but they've refused to follow through and enforce the contract with Akshay Patra.
Rahul Ishwar, you want to rebut? That's evidence for you.
He's saying almost 80% and 20% is opting out. On the other second, he is saying that only 90% is being reached. See, please, we have to be realistic when we do such a mammoth project. He is saying only 7% of schools are being catered at. The whole point is, you can see the posturing of Akshay Patra. They were open to suggestions. They were saying that if you have some suggestions, we are ready to be there for it. But the whole point is, the everyone feels, especially on our side of spectrum, that Akshay Patra is being demonized for political reasons. Akshay Patra is being demonized for religious or spiritual reasons. There are Jain philosophical culture, Hindu philosophical culture, which has some issues with onion and garlic. Yes, there is a spiritual strain to it. We feel that that argument is being used and Akshay Patra is being piggybacked.
No. Okay, all right. So Rahul Ishwar, to free you from this conundrum that you're in, let me rephrase the question. Let me rephrase the entire question for the whole panel. Eggs or no eggs? How's that for a question? This has nothing to do with the contractor that you are referring to. Let's leave Akshay Patra out of the conversation. Eggs or no eggs for the children in school? Let's remember, when we say that the 20% of the children are opting out, it means that they're not eating the prescribed meal
for eggs
that is supposed to give them the nutritional boost. When we're saying they're only consuming 90%, it means that they're leaving food on their plates.
Should be
yes.
An
all right.
Essential part
Dr. Ramamurthy, eggs or no eggs? Yes.
School children's diet at least thrice a week.
Okay. Eggs should be at least thrice
eggs,
a week.
I'm for it. Eggs should be a part of this midday meals and should be supplied at least thrice a week because they have all the essential amino acids and they are very, very necessary. And poor children, you must understand that poor children attend these government schools, children from low socio-economic background, and majority of them enjoy egg. They are used to onion and garlic included in their diet.
Okay, all right. Rahul Ishwar, rebuttal.
You know, cannot deny the right to food of 98% of the people. Only 2% may not eat.
We need to take care of, just two lines. We need to take care of the cultural sensitivities. If tomorrow somebody says beef is rich, that we have to provide it in schools, it may trigger a debate because Article 48 in Indian Constitution calls for some kind of a slaughter, ban on slaughter of cows. So cultural sensitivity.
No, but one second, Rahul Ishwar, eggs are, eggs, Rahul Ishwar, do I have to explain
eggs
to you where
I
eggs
don't
come
see
from?
Why we are bringing in beef.
No, one second. Let me just check. Rahul Ishwar, do you know where eggs come from?
When two
chickens meet and fall
tomorrow,
in love. No,
tomorrow,
okay, you, I don't have to explain that. All right, go
that
ahead.
Tomorrow somebody can say that they are not providing beef because they have a religious reason for it, they have a spiritual reason for it.
Rahul Ishwar, so it's not prescribed in the government. Okay, one second. No. That's completely
ridiculous.
Taking a left
that's
turn on this conversation. Completely
because
unnecessary. All right, Dr.
That's
Chandra, one second.
Argument.
I just want to point out to our audience, nobody on this panel...
One second.
I just want to point out to the audience, nobody on this panel thought up the idea of eggs in midday meals. It's prescribed by the government of India and by various state governments as the one thing that can quickly fix a lot of nutritional problems that these children would have if they went without. Eggs are easy to access, they're easy to source, they're cheaper, they can be boiled and supplied quickly. And a lot of these children would suffer from severe problems if they didn't get the protein that was available in that
and
egg.
And there is no contamination with egg supply at
there's
all.
There's no contamination. Yeah. Yes. All right. Yeah. Dr. Chandra, go ahead.
And Faye, let me also say...
You're fine. Let's look at it.
Yes, Dr. Chandra.
One second, please.
Yes, Dr. Chandra.
You know, let's look at it at a very, very level, which is very simple level. Let's talk about malnutrition in India. In children in the sector that comes from a marginalized community, let's look at malnutrition. These children are malnourished in every single nutrient, from macronutrients such as protein and good energy. They're also malnourished in vitamins and minerals. We're talking about every child of our country now having vitamin B12, folate, calcium, vitamin D3, iron deficiency. You know the statistics for anemia? 56% of our girls have anemia, clinical anemia, and many more have less iron in their body. A simple thing such as having a nutritional meal, which as you correctly said, is the square meal for these children. I'll give you an example. I'll work with a project called the National Anemia Eradication Program, which runs in the suburbs in Delhi, in Kapaseda and other places, which are migrant populations outside Delhi. These children literally eat only the midday meal because they have really nothing else to eat. And in such a situation where they probably eat just boiled rice for dinner and probably always come to school without a breakfast, why should not the midday meal take care of their nutrition? Because that's the one place where the government can correct that major missing out of nutrients. And these children are not fed. They require to be fed. And if they don't like the food they eat, if it's not nutritionally balanced, if it does not have something as simple as egg, as a lot of people have pointed out, is a complete protein with all the amino acids. It's rich in folate and zinc.
Yes.
And magnesium and vitamins and minerals, why should it not be a part of this? And also the last thing, Faye, is that midday meals also, let's keep on repeating that just because a company or an organization is doing a good job in terms of hygiene does not complete the circle. The circle gets completed only if the food is hygienic, safe, nutritious, tasty, and consumed by the child. And okay, that will happen when you add the right ingredients. Let's add the vegetables. Let's add the herbs, please.
All right. Okay. I want to leave it here, but I thank my panel for giving us the time to have this conversation today. I just want to leave my audience with some statistics. India has the largest number of malnourished children in the world. 50%. So half of the world's population of underfed children live in India and are our responsibility. Under the age of 5, 37% of our children are currently underweight. 21% are what they call wasted, which is the weight is far too low for the height. And 8% are severely and acutely malnourished. Now, what we must remember is if we don't feed these children, it doesn't matter what you teach them and what opportunities you provide them later in life, their brains and their bodies will never develop enough to compete on an equal plane. Their brains and their bodies will never develop enough to take full advantage of any opportunity they're given when they grow up. They will just not be able to keep up. Everything, almost everything, depends on the nutrition they receive in this very crucial age group. And the prescribed dosage of nutrition has been done after a great deal of research by the government of India. All we are saying is follow it. And if there are children who don't want the eggs, have them opt out. But we cannot use religious philosophy to dictate what these children will and will not eat simply because they're poor. That is not fair. Thanks for watching.